In this video, we'll study about the tympanic membrane or eardrum. It is an oval, semi-transparent, pearly grey, trilaminar membrane, and it separates the tympanic cavity from the external acoustic meatus. Its maximum diameter measures about 9 to 10 millimeter and minimum is about 8 to 9 millimeter. When you see the position, the membrane is placed obliquely, making an acute angle of 55 degree with the floor of the external acoustic meatus. In the newborn, the membrane is almost horizontal, hence the child can withstand noisy sound better than the adult. This is a picture of otoscopic view of right tympanic membrane. When you see, this is the circumference of the tympanic membrane. The circumference of the membrane is made up of fibrocartilaginous ring, which is attached to the sulcus of the tympanic plate at the bottom of the external acoustic meatus. The sulcus is deficient above, so here you will not have sulcus, from the two ends of which you have the anterior and posterior malleolar folds, which converge to the lateral process of the malleus in the upper part of the tympanic membrane. When you see the subdivisions of the membrane, the malleolar folds divide the tympanic membrane into two parts. This part, small part, is known as the pars flaccida. It is a small triangular lax area above the malleolar fold, and sometimes it presents a small perforation. This larger area is known as the pars tensa. The pars tensa occupies the rest of the membrane, which is rendered taut by the attachment of the handle of the malleus and by the disposition of the radiating fibers of the intermediate layer from the handle. Next, we'll see about the surfaces of the membrane. So this surface is the lateral surface. The lateral surface is concave and it is directed downward, forward and laterally. As a result, the anterior and the floor of the external acoustic meatus are longer than the posterior and the roof. This surface is the medial surface. The medial surface of the membrane is convex and it bulges towards the tympanic cavity. The maximum point of convexity is known as the umbo. This surface receives the attachment of the handle of the malleus, which intervenes between the fibrous and the mucous layer, and it extends from above with a downward and somewhat backward inclination up to the center of the membrane. Here, the handle of the malleus is crossed medially by the cauda tympani nerve, which runs forward between the fibrous and the mucous layer of the membrane at the junction of the pars flaccida and pars tensa. In this picture, you can see this is the medial surface of the tympanic membrane and this is the cauda tympani nerve. So it crosses the handle of the malleus medially between the fibrous and the mucous layer of the tympanic membrane at the junction of the pars flaccida and pars tensa. Next, we'll see about the structure of the tympanic membrane. From outside inward, it consists of three strata. So this is the outer cuticular layer. The outer cuticular layer is lined by hairless, keratinized, stratified squamous epithelium, and it is continuous with the skin of the external acoustic meatus. The cuticular layer is devoid of dermal papillae. Then you have the intermediate layer. The intermediate layer consists of outer radiating and inner circular fibers. So when you see the radiating fibers, the radiating fibers diverge from the handle of the malleus to the periphery. And the circular fibers are abundant at the periphery and scanty in the center. In the pars flaccida, the fibrous stratum is replaced by loose connective tissue. The innermost layer is the mucus layer, and it is lined by simple columnar or squamous epithelium with patches of ciliated cells in the upper part of the membrane. The mucus layer of the tympanic membrane presents three recesses. This is the anterior recess in between the handle of the malleus and the anterior fold. So when you see, there will be a small pouch like here. So this is called as the anterior recess. This contains the cauda tympani nerve. And this is the posterior recess in between the handle of the malleus and the posterior malleolar fold. This also contains the cauda tympani nerve. And this is the superior recess or the Prushak's pouch. It is a mucus recess above the lateral process of the malleus, intervening between the neck of the malleus and the pars flaccida of the tympanic membrane. Next, we'll see about the arterial supply. The tympanic membrane is supplied by the following arteries. So, the cuticular layer. The cuticular layer is supplied by the deep auricular branch of the maxillary artery. Whereas the mucus layer is supplied by the stylomastoid branch of posterior auricular artery and also the anterior tympanic branch of maxillary artery. Next, we'll see about the venous drainage. The outer layer drains into the external jugular vein and the inner layer drains into the transverse sinus and the pterygoid venous plexus. Next, we'll see about the nerve supply. First, we'll see about the nerve supply of the cuticular layer. The auricular temporal nerve supplies the upper and the anterior part of the membrane, and the auricular branch of vagus nerve supplies the lower and posterior part of the membrane. The mucus layer of the tympanic membrane is supplied by the glossopharyngeal nerve through the tympanic plexus. Next, we'll see the development. The tympanic membrane is developed from the three sources, each representing the three germinal layers of the embryonic disc. The cuticular layer is developed from the ectoderm of the dorsal end of the first branchial cleft. The intermediate fibrous layer is derived from the mesoderm of the adjoining branchial arches. The inner mucus layer is developed from the endoderm of the tubotympanic recess, which is formed by the fusion of the dorsal ends of the first and the second branchial pouches. Next, we'll see about the external examination of the tympanic membrane by means of ear speculum. It reveals the following features. So you can see this is a cone of light. So this is a cone of light. It is reflected from the antero-inferior quadrant of the membrane. So this is from the antero-inferior quadrant of the membrane. Beneath the membrane, you can see the handle of the malleus as a yellow streak extending from the center upward and forward. A white prominence in the upper part of the streak represents the lateral process of the malleus. This is another picture of the otoscopic view of the tympanic membrane of left side. So here you can see the cone of light which forms the anteroinferior quadrant, and this is the handle of the malleus, and this prominence is the lateral process of the malleus. So behind and parallel to the handle you can see the incus. So this is the incus. You can see this is the long process of the incus. So it is also appears as a white streak behind and parallel to the upper part of the handle of the malleus. Next we'll see about the deep relations of the tympanic membrane. The anteroinferior quadrant is related to the carotid canal. The anterosuperior quadrant is related to the tympanic opening of the auditory tube. The posterosuperior quadrant is related to the long process of the incus, stapes and the fenestra vestibuli. The posteroinferior quadrant is related to the promontory and the fenestra cochlea. When you see the applied anatomy, a surgical incision of the tympanic membrane, that is known as the meningotomy, should be made in the posteroinferior part in order to avoid injury to the caudal tympani nerve and the ossicles of the ear.